as we say in showbiz. Hi, this is Continuous Improvement Television, and I'm Jack ReVelle. Today, my guest is a very, very special person, a longtime pioneer in the field of continuous improvement, Dorian Shainin. Before we turn our attention to Dorian, let me bring you up to date on our future telecasts. Next month, which will be the final telecast in this, the first series for 1994, will be Dr. George Labovitz. George is a professor of management and the founder of the Organizational Dynamics Incorporated, ODI, in Boston University, where he's a professor of management. And we also have coming up next February the president of ASI, that's the American Supplier Institute International, Steve Ungvari, who will be talking about TRIZ, T-R-I-Z. It's an acronym for a problem-solving technique that's evolved in Russia over the last 40 or so years, and he'll be talking to us about that next February. And then in March, we will have Peter Schultes talking about why we use teams. In April, Bill Conway, the head of Conway Quality, formerly the CEO and chairman of Nashua Corporation, the first American corporation to recognize the genius of Dr. W. Edwards Deming and use his ideas, his applications, his techniques in the operation of an organization here in the United States. Come the month of May, we have Shin Taguchi, who will be talking about robust design and the use of the quality loss function. And then our final operation, our final telecast in June of next year will be Dr. George Box, Professor Emeritus and now Director of Research for the Center for Productivity and Quality at the University of Wisconsin at Madison. That's what we have looking forward to, but today, a treat, a real treat, a real human being, a real pioneer in quality, my guest, Dorian Shainin. Dorian, I want you to know what a real pleasure it is to have you on the telecast. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a man who's been around on this earth for 80 years, and for virtually 50 of those years has been sharing with us his understanding, his knowledge, as Dr. Deming would say, his profound knowledge of the problems that we face in the world of business and industry each day, and has been sharing with us his insights and how to solve those problems. Dorian, welcome to Continuous Improvement Television.
Thank you, Jack. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to try in a short space of time to see if you can understand the very logical, common sense concepts behind a thing called statistical engineering, which I really would predict might be a revolutionary thing for the future. So please pay attention to the notes that we've distributed for you, and don't hesitate to ask questions. Normally we take about 6 days to present this in seminar form. We've got 2 hours, but I hope to get the fundamentals across as we move ahead.
Terrific. Just a little housekeeping, just to make sure that everybody knows what we'll be doing. We've just come on the air, and in about 55 or so minutes, we'll take a break. So we'll take a break from 5 minutes to the hour till 5 minutes after the hour depending on what time zone here in the United States that you're already in. And during the period of these 2 hours that we have together, I would urge you to call or fax in your questions. Sooner or later, we're going to get some numbers up there on the screen, and these will be the numbers here in Massachusetts that you can call. I see the telephone number on there now, area code 413-545-4871. And the fax number now, 413-545-1227. I always get a kick out of reading those phone numbers and fax numbers. I feel like this is a telethon. You don't have to pledge any money. We want you to pledge the fact that you're going to try Dorian's techniques to help you to solve problems. And you should have in front of you at each of the various downlink sites across the country a full set of notes that Dorian provided us in advance so that you can follow close up what it is that Dorian's talking about. Now, I should point out that Dorian has a rather interesting affliction, if I may call it that.
Yep.
I believe it's pronounced
macular
degeneration. And this means that his eyesight has begun to fail. But I assure you, nothing else has. You know, we've been together for about a day now as we prepared for the telecast, and his mind, his wit is as sharp as ever. His jokes are as bad as ever, but his wit, his understanding, his perception of the problems and how to go about solving them is as good as it's ever been, which is exceptional. And so what I'm going to do is begin our telecast by having a brief chat with Dorian, talking about some of the background of how we got started in the world of consulting and discovered some of the techniques and some background stories. And then as we proceed, Dorian will get into the use of the notes and talk to you about some of these techniques that he has either personally developed or popularized. You'll notice here I got my hands on Dorian's notes. They are larger than your notes because of this affliction of his, and as a result, we've expanded them so to facilitate his ability to see the notes. But they're absolutely identical to the ones that you have. And from time to time, he'll be using pointers to identify a specific item on there that we will blow up to make sure that you can see exactly what he's pointing at. But let me take some time now and talk about Dorian Shainin, the man, the person behind the legend. There's no question in my mind, although you're too modest to admit it, that you are a living legend in the area of design of experiments and in the area of statistical engineering and process improvement, product improvement. I seem to recall that you got your start as a graduate in aeronautical engineering from MIT in 1936. Right. You went to work for a company at that time that was called United Technology.
United Aircraft.
United Aircraft at that time. And you spent how many years with them?
16 years.
16 years, yep. In a variety of capacities. At one point, you were the director of quality, had 1,000 people working for you.
That's right.
And then one day you had a revelation. ReVelle's have revelations, but so do Shainin's. And that revelation was, what am I doing here? You know, running myself into the ground, not learning anything as a director of quality. And that's when you first had the idea of becoming a consultant. Is that right?
That's right. Statistical quality control was getting to be recognized by many, many companies as something they're going to have to get into. This is way back. We're talking about 1952 now.
1952, yeah. Before many of our viewers were born.
Yeah.
And they were using statistical quality control even then.
Mm, that's right. And so I was approached by a consulting firm in Boston, Rath & Strong Management Consultants, stayed with them 23 years,
mm-hmm.
Became their senior vice president, had over 400 clients, and was beginning to enjoy life. Yep.
And then you retired from Rath & Strong about 20 years ago?
Yep.
And began your third career as an independent consultant?
That's right.
And now you have Shainin Consultants with your sons Peter.
Peter and
Richard.
Richard, yeah.
As well as about a dozen others that are a part of your organization.
That's right.
Not only in the United States, but if I recall, outside the United States as well.
Yep, definitely.
And what do you folks do? What does Shainin Consultants do for industry?
We take problems that clients have that they've tried to solve the usual way, of year after year made very little progress, redesigned things to try to get rid of problems and so on. And we found, you know, when you're having troubles, so there are some good ones and some not so good. You don't need to redesign it. It's just a question of what's different about it.
Mm-hmm.
And we use techniques I'll be briefly discussing in these 2 hours, fundamentals, so you can discover the real root cause of the difficulty.
And the big red X.
The big red X, as we call it. Yep,
right.
It's coming.
Just off the top of your head, If you were to think back about one particular problem that you faced that had especially outstanding results, what would that problem be?
The lunar module of the Apollo project.
Mm.
And I worked with Grumman, the prime contractor, and we were all trying to be sure that we could get those three astronauts back alive
right.
each time. And I want to say that reliability activity that we taught the Grumman people and they spread to all their suppliers made the lunar module much, much more reliable than the rest of Apollo. And we'll talk about Apollo 13. Maybe mm-hmm. some of you remember enough now that we've had a 25-year announcement about remembering what happened at the time, going to the moon and everything. So that's the thing I enjoyed the most. It was really, as an aeronautical engineer,
it was
just terrific.
How about, what was the biggest dollar savings you ever accomplished for a client?
Well, now that we've gotten into the big three, the General Motors activities and Chrysler and Ford, beginning to teach them. And by the way, the people that make all these savings are not us. It's the people working mm-hmm. in the company, but in very small teams. We'll be discussing that with you. The trouble with most of this teamwork we found in companies we were hired in, the teams were too big, too many people, too many theories and ideas, you know.
How big should a team be?
Three people.
Three people?
Yep, no more than three. And we'll be discussing the departments they should represent.
Okay.
This is coming along, yep.
Very good. What can you think of, what was the largest dollar savings you ever achieved for a client?
Well, it was running over $20 million a year in big automotive companies, you know, where mm-hmm. things are really, really very, very active.
Over $20 million a year?
Oh, yeah. And year after year, once they got it, you know, it's
that's
recurring
phenomenal.
Savings.
Do you get a percentage of that?
No.
Well, what a shame.
It's unethical. It's, you know, we have a code of ethics in consulting.
Yeah, I know you're a CMC, a Certified
Management Consultant.
Yeah.
And our code of ethics says you charge per day for services. You do not charge on returns like lawyers or doctors mm-hmm. or things like that.
You don't get a percentage. That's
you don't
a shame.
Get a percentage.
You're too ethical. Okay, there's no such thing as being too ethical, obviously.
Right. Right.
This team you have of there's a total of 14 of you now that are
yep,
Shainin Consultants.
That's right.
People were as a result of hearing what you have to say today, interested in contacting you, what would be the best way to make contact with Shainin Consultants?
Well, we've got a phone number and a fax number on the first part of the handout.
Let's blow that up.
All right.
We could use one of your colored pointers there.
Yeah. I get these from the airlines, by the way. They cost me $4 a piece. But they're deductible on my income tax.
Very
right?
good. Okay, so we see there the phone numbers, both area code 203-646-4429 is the phone number, and the fax number, it's fixed now, right?
Yep.
Is 645. I just thought I'd mention that.
Right.
Oh, they had a problem with the fax number the other day. 645-0551.
Yeah.
And that will put you in contact with Shainin Consultants.
Well, with me personally.
With you personally.
Now, we do have a headquarters contact in Carson City, Nevada.
Do you recall what the phone
And that one
that?
Is on one of the next, well, let's see. I guess that's on the appendix at the back.
Okay. Well, we'll look at that later
that,
on
right,
then.
Right. Yeah.
Okay. I think that, you know, that's really enough background to let people know that, you know, that you're real, you know, that there is a person behind the name Shainin, and that there's an organization behind the person, and that you've got, you know, 40-plus years of experience. Mm-hmm. That ought to be enough for most executives to say, you know, this guy has some stability.
Thank you.
So why don't we talk a little bit about the Shainin methodology, statistical engineering. Why don't you kind of give us a kind of an overview of what it includes?
Well, actually, I've been taught, or I learned the hard way, the way to start one of these things is to indicate quickly some of the benefits, get people listening to what they can look forward to,
okay.
and then explain how you get it after you see the benefits.
Mm-hmm.
So why don't we go to the first slide, if we can here,
okay.
and we'll go to the United Kingdom, Lucas is a rather well-known name in the automotive industry in England, and they've very kindly given us permission to indicate that they had a fuel injector problem, and they could only get about 50% of this induction hardening activity to work just right. It was kind of a complicated process.
Was this plastics or metal?
No, this is metal.
Okay.
On induction hardening, and they worked at it, and they were about to come to a plant closure, as you see here on the first slide.
Mm-hmm.
The team of three, representing people from design engineering, from manufacturing engineering, and quality engineering, working together using these techniques you're mm-hmm. going to be hearing a little bit about, in a very, very short time, found the real root cause, could turn the problem on and off, just like a switch.
Wow.
And they got, as you see on the slide, a tremendous OEM order from their customers, and the plant is still going, and the They didn't have to shut down, and they're just as excited as can be.
I would be, too.
And, you know, the idea being that they really are the ones that did it. Mm-hmm. All we did was give them the foundations, the fundamentals.
So could I say that you gave them the key and they turned it?
They did. And they did it beautifully.
That's terrific.
And to show that it's not just an unusual thing, if we go to the next slide, mm-hmm. we'll come into the United States. At the time, it was called Detroit Diesel Allison, mm-hmm. a division of General Motors. And then Penske bought in to a large controlling share. It's now Detroit Diesel Corporation. But they kept the management there and the people we had originally trained mm-hmm. In these teams. And you can see that they were losing their share of market in diesel engines because of reliability problems.
That's a significant drop.
Oh, yeah, tremendous, as
That's
you can
like
see.
That's like a factor of 10.
And then as they started to apply statistical engineering, where, by the way, we forced failures to find out where the weakest failure modes were, one by one. And sure enough, as you can see in the next part of the slide, they've recovered their market, their business is booming. And I guess I should really point to another air. By the way, the first airline we had was Western Airlines. You can see
the W. Bring that over here.
Yep, right.
There we go. Now you can see the Western.
But now here we have Braniff International pointing to what I'd like you to read, which is... Okay.
The techniques taught by Shainin were a key part of the Series 60 achievement of outstanding reliability right out of the chute. And that's a quote from Mr. Cosey?
Cosey, yep.
Who is the president of Detroit Diesel.
And the first engine a while back got into 1,000,000 miles without any overhaul or anything else, no failures.
Magnificent.
And now we're up to the latest report I had is 100 production engines have made it. And
to 1,000,000 miles.
Oh, yeah. They think their competitive advantage now is just fabulous.
And I thought my Buick was good.
Now, how do we get about doing all of this? And the answer is, how do you eat an elephant? So the military concept is basically divide and conquer. So our techniques basically take total variation and separate it into independent families or components. Not variable by variable, because there are too darn many possible
individuals,
variables.
Yeah.
Instead, groups of variables. And that's part of the secret of all of this,
uh-huh.
is how to divide the total into manageable groups of hundreds of thousands of X's simultaneously, mm-hmm. and which ones can you eliminate until you narrow down by a process of elimination.
Are these like categories?
Yeah, you're going to see examples of
okay,
that as
terrific.
We go further.
Okay.
Yep. So we take total variation of a specific quality characteristic one at a time that's causing a problem,
mm-hmm.
a real serious problem. And, of course, automatically you get productivity improvements because you have you prevent making any bad parts at all. You really do get zero defects. Instead of a goal, it's an actual accomplishment to be able to do this. And, of course, if our productivity and manufacturing costs go down and our quality goes up, this ratio I've got on this slide we're looking at here, the quality per buck we can call value.
Mm-hmm.
And when you get such a breakthrough, as we've seen in those typical case histories for these breakthroughs, you can begin to see that the old popular phrase of getting customer satisfaction competitively mm-hmm. can change. Value has a major influence on customer enthusiasm. That means the customer doesn't want to buy from a competitor. Why should they compare one product against another? And this is basically how General Motors decided over 10 years ago to get started with us, and it's been spreading now because I found out, much to my surprise, one major executive at an automotive company talks to other major executives, and so now we have all three of them learning
all
how
all
to
the
use
big
these
three.
Techniques. Yeah.
Yeah. Now you've worked at Ford and Chrysler as well too, haven't you?
Yeah. Definitely.
There's some great advantage, if I recall.
Well,
we're
very pleased. Yeah. So in order to do this. And this is a challenge. You can't think the way you've been thinking before. I don't know how many of you in the audience are familiar with the word paradigm. For some over 40 years, I've never used the word until Joel Barker. Some of you have heard about him. He's 1992. He He had a book called Paradigm, and he describes a paradigm shift. And the important thing, if you really want to be a successful practitioner, professional in this business, a good statistical engineer, is to keep your theories and possible tenable hypotheses back until you get new clues. It's like a detective. And the clues don't come from experts or from people, they come from the product itself. So I'm going to try to teach you how to talk to the pieces and the assemblies.
So just like you have the voice of the customer and the voice of the engineer, you've got the voice of the process and the voice of the product.
Yeah. And interestingly, the Red X that you mentioned briefly is so easy to find once you get the clues. Mm-hmm. Just amazing, as we'll get further into this as we go along. So you have to really think about practicing a very major way in changing your approach to problem solving.
So you, I guess the philosophy that you're espousing is don't be so rigid at the, as you walk into a new situation that you think that the way you've solved previous problems is the way you're going to solve this problem.
Nothing wrong with putting out fires if it's that obvious.
Yeah.
But the tough ones that just don't want to be solved, you can't turn on and off, or you thought you turned it off and it comes back again a week or so later, that's when you need statistical engineering.
You know, it's funny you should say that, because I had a boss at Hughes in Fullerton, California, a number of years ago. He's subsequently retired. But he told me something very similar to that when I first joined his organization back about 1982. Mm-hmm. He says, I know I can solve any problem in this plant. I know it because I've solved them all five times. And that's exactly what you're just saying.
Well
they keep
put.
Coming back.
Well put. So it's a major paradigm shift. But you have to, and you can't get it by just reading a book. You've got to practice it.
Yeah.
It's like playing a piano. I could give you a book on where the black keys are and the white keys and how to read music, and you first try it, it's terrible. You got to practice, and then finally you get it.
Well, that's why when they're teaching kids to drive, it's not just a classroom thing.
Exactly.
They put them in a car as well.
Exactly.
I mean, experience truly is invaluable.
Yep, you got it. Now, one of the basic ideas is to give you a picture of what does a Red X look like. Some of you may have heard of Vilfredo Pareto, the Italian economist that said in this world things are never equally contributing. There's one richest person in the world, second to the richest, the rest of us work for a living.
Well, you're the second richest.
Yeah, right. Then there's the master criminal, the best criminal in the world, then there's the second to the greatest, and the rest of them are punks. You just can't seem to get everybody to be equally effective. And you know, there are people, unfortunately, that think things in this world are random. They're not. There's always a Pareto. As you see here, a largest one, the second to the greatest, third as we go along. Now, the important key thing, different than the Pareto stuff you read about in the textbooks and so on, is this key word variation we have on the vertical axis. And these bars you see here are measures a variability around an average, and there's a statistical distribution in the third dimension with a tail at the bottom, a tail at the other end, and a peak somewhere near the middle. Not necessarily symmetrical, not necessarily normal, but of some distribution shape, but they don't contribute equally to delta y variation. Now we're going to use the letter y as, and if you're taking notes, ladies and gentlemen, write it down. Y is the single quality characteristic perceived by the customer. There are thousands and thousands of X's along the horizontal axis. As they vary, causes of variation, they cause Y to vary, but not equally. The largest one is the red X, the second to the largest, pink X, third to the largest, pale pink
X,
then they get to be the trivial stuff. As my good friend Joe Duran has said over and over again, the trivial many and the vital few.
Right.
And I give them a lot of credit for that. And we call the big one, the leading one, Red X. Most people don't realize, if I put a pointer from Delta Airlines right here, that there's a statistical principle that magnifies the relative size greater than what we see in this picture. And that's what makes this thing easy to be able to detect, to discover this red X. You're going to see it when I get to some of the principles very shortly.
Let me mention to the audience, this morning before we drove here to Amherst, Massachusetts, we were at Dorian and Margaret Shainin's home in Manchester, Connecticut, and they were showing me their car. Dorian's car is a beautiful red Corvette, gorgeous car, and the license plate says Red X1. This guy is serious, folks.
You're right. Nothing happens without a reason in this world, and it's not 10 things at once or 15 things. It's not common causes. It's not things at random. It's a single interaction or main effect. Mm-hmm. And I will be able to describe and show you some pictures of what an interaction is, because you can have a red X interaction.
Sure.
And they cannot be predicted. You got to discover them.
Mm-hmm.
So this is coming along as we go later. Too many people work on the theory that maybe there's no Pareto. But I've got to tell you, this is not. And by the way, there's nothing wrong with having a mania for quality and everybody wanting to do the job right.
But a passion.
Yeah, a passion. It takes more than that. You've got to have analytical techniques to find that unknown red X, mm-hmm, to be able to do it. And so that's really what we're trying to do here. You've got to go beyond wanting to do a good job. You've got to have the tools, the analytical techniques for it. Okay.
Okay.
Now, the whole profession of statistical engineering basically is based on two truths. A truth is an axiom, and they're very simple and logical. And to really understand and believe these, you've got to practice on, mm-hmm, shop floors to see that the really, as we say here, nothing in manufacturing is ever equally likely. In fact, the only thing that's random in this world is a table of random numbers artificially made that way by humans in order to have the probabilities come out equal. In the real world on shop floors, there's always an undiscovered leading cause, interaction or main effect. That's axiom number one.
I've had a number of mornings when I've woken up and I felt like I'd been totally randomized.
Axiom number two. If you take a measure of variability that many of you in the quality business are familiar with, called a standard deviation, sigma, and you got one sigma from X1, another sigma from X2, X3. Ladies and gentlemen, they don't add.
That's right.
Independent standard deviations. Why don't they add? Well, because they're going in opposite directions, sometimes similar directions. They counteract each other.
They're like vectors going off,
exactly,
in different directions.
However, if you square the standard deviation, what do we get? A thing called variance, sigma squared. It's a statistical truth, an axiom, mm-hmm, that independent variances, sigma squareds, are additive. And when I began to realize this many, many years ago, everything opened up. Because that red X you saw bigger than the pink X, if one is 5 times the other, now becomes 25 times, because you're squaring 5 and you're squaring 1. And anything that has that dramatic influence can be discovered by a process of elimination strategy that we're going to be getting into shortly. And so it's not difficult to find that main effect or interaction.
Okay.
The strategy that we use, the process of elimination, to take advantage of those two axioms, that there's always a leading cause and its effect is magnified relative to the others, believe it or not, comes from pure fiction. Arthur Conan Doyle, over 100 years ago, when he wrote the Sherlock Holmes series, and I've got a quotation, mm-hmm, you can all read, where Sherlock Holmes was saying, in this thing written in 1890, to his assistant, Dr. Watson,
right,
when you have eliminated everything that's impossible, whatever remains, a single thing that remains, no matter how improbable, has got to be the truth.
Yep.
And it's more than just a very clever detective approach. It really does work.
It makes sense.
Oh, and it works beautifully. So we do use that. Now, that team of three we talked about.
Mm-hmm.
You never know where the red X is going to show up, either in engineering design or tolerances, drawings, specifications for materials, or something from a supplier, or it may be in your manufacturing activity, tools, fixtures, fabrication equipment, or it may be in the gauges, instruments we use to measure the parts. So you've got to have a representation from three departments. I found in with my earlier clients, if a quality man finds a red
or woman.
Or woman, exactly, yeah. Thank you. Other department heads will not change designs or drawings or fixtures unless their own people find it out. So the simple solution to these invisible walls I find in all of my clients separating engineering from manufacturing, from quality, can be broken through by putting a representative of each of those three departments together.
A true cross-functional team.
Yeah, and they get the clues. And so they jointly find the red X, and then the particular person can go to his department head and say, I can turn it on and off.
Mm-hmm.
And that does get implementation. So
that's
it's
great.
Very important to do that. And so we've got a list of the departments, a reminder for you. I found in many of my clients, annual quality improvement teams, 12 people, they get in each other's way, too many theories. Everybody's trying to guess where this red X is, and you don't solve mm-hmm. problems by guessing. You'll find them based on these two axioms and this process of elimination. And the team has to really suffer through this paradigm mm-hmm. shift. I'm trying to think of the right word here. It's not easy. You make up your mind you're going to do it, but you've got to practice it.
Anytime you shift from one model to another,
oh, God, yes.
You know, there's a lot of personal pain that goes into
yep,
it.
Yeah, that's right. We have developed over those years 30 techniques. Sometimes they work together. We've given them all names. They're unusual, unique techniques. There are no assumptions. One of the big things I've done in trying to get away from textbooks and the academic mm-hmm. kind of thing here that really fits the real world is that you've got to basically avoid restrictive assumptions that make it easy to write a textbook, but difficult to actually support in factories. And so you see, we start at the top with a definition of the fact that that's one why. If there are two whys, two quality characteristics giving you trouble in your own plant, next operation, mm-hmm. or the final customer, you have two of these projects, each why.
Dorian, for the sake of our watchers,
mm-hmm.
Let's talk about some typical whys. Let's say you're producing automobile tires. What would a typical why be? Like
In the field of reliability, a blowout.
Okay.
Or a leak.
Okay.
And you've got to realize you've got environments that can bring this about, but basically you'd like to, if you're going to be designing the lunar module part of Apollo, you've got to recognize that you've got to be impervious to these. You've got to have a margin of safety. Using an aeronautical engineering expression.
Suppose we were developing a portable radio, what would be a typical why?
Interference in stations, holding a frequency, you know, being able to tune it.
Okay.
Let's
see, how about the picture on a television screen?
Resolution, contrast, avoiding the horizontal lines mm-hmm. that you sometimes get on a TV screen.
And you say there can be more than one why.
Usually there's one leading why that you want to get to first because it has the greatest influence on customer, what was that word again?
Satisfaction.
No,
enthusiasm.
No, you got it. Enthusiasm, right. And if you have to continue to beat your competition with a second why on that same product, then it's a separate project. Now, very interestingly, we found, much to our great surprise, the dependability of the measuring system is very important.
Oh, absolutely.
Sometimes the red X is in your instrument, the fixtures, the measuring, and people have metrology rooms and they think by calibrating things and periodically checking on mm-hmm. calibration that you're going to solve the problem. It takes more than that to be able to do it. And there's a little closed loop right here that's very important,
mm-hmm.
which is don't form any theories until you have clues. A minimum of two or three clues pointing in, like triangulation, on the same unknown, so it can't escape you. And then you have to be able to demonstrate through designed experiments and monitoring activities that you can turn it on and off, just like a key or a switch,
mm-hmm.
to be able to show you have control. And so basically, the limit in the limiting current thinking, the current paradigm called the scientific method, which, by the way, has what we learned in school as being very logical, define your problem, form tenable hypotheses, hold everything constant except what you think is the most important one, change only one thing at a time, and then see if it can make sense. And unfortunately, the red X almost always, on a tough problem,
evades that. Yep.
And so that's the biggest problem we have.
And I know that you were taught it at MIT in the 50s. I was taught that at Purdue in the 50s.
Right.
And I know that still today in some of the finest schools in the country, they're still teaching that kind of thinking here in the 80s and 90s.
I do think there's a revolution ahead of us. I think I've got over 900 companies doing it very successfully now. But that's just a drop of the bucket when you think of how much industry we have in the whole country.
Yeah, but we got to get that stuff back into the academic people
right.
So they begin to start teaching it.
Right. Now, I'd like to be able to point to the fact that we need to have a way of using statistical process control to be able to monitor what we're doing. And we found that using control charts and getting control limits, all of which I kind of grew up with, so the
Me too.
Work that I got from Walter Shewhart and so on.
Did you know him?
Oh, yes, I did.
You knew Shewhart?
Yeah, I talked with him.
That's scary. You know, it's scary enough talking to you as a legend to know that you knew Shewhart.
Oh, yeah.
And next year, of course, you know, I'll have George Box on, and,
right.
and he's the former son-in-law of Sir Ronald Fisher.
That's right.
I feel like I'm dropping back, into the Middle Ages almost.
Well, those were the pioneers, you know, the giants. And they've done a marvelous job, but what are we doing today? We're standing on the shoulders of these giants.
Mm-hmm.
We can see a little further, maybe, than they did originally. And so what we're doing, write this down, mending, improving. We take the original contributions, we remove the restrictive assumptions, and we've got it now so statistical engineers get exact probabilities, not approximately or close enough kind of things. Because when you're an aeronautical engineer, you don't want that one in a thousand.
That's right. You don't want to be on that plane.
Oh, that's right. And so here we have, it's like a flow diagram.
Right.
That shows kind of a rough guide of the system we have for improving quality, improving reliability. And I'm sure you can all use this as a guide. Now, on X bar and R charts, control charts, amending the improvement starts on the next slide, where we've divided the total tolerance into zones, colored zones. It took four of us at working together at Rath and Strong, doing this with Jones and Lamson Machine Company in Springfield, Vermont. It's called pre-control. You have no control limits, no charts. You got to learn how to count to two and to five, and we find operators like to do that. We take the total tolerance and we divide the tolerance into a center target area zone, colored green on the gauge, two outer zones, quarter of the tolerance, colored yellow, and we have a rule shown here that says if you get two consecutive parts where the needle on your gauge or instrument points to yellow, two consecutive yellows, do something right away. Don't wait for a subgroup of four. Don't wait for averages and ranges to be able to do this sort of a thing. I don't know what it is about statistical things, but averages are so popular. And my favorite story is this duck hunter fires at a duck, the bullet goes to the left of the duck.
I'm almost afraid to hear what you're going to say.
He adjusts his aim, he fires again, the bullet goes to the right of the duck. Now, on the average, a duck should be dead.
But
he flies away. Beware of the averages. You lose information. And so in statistical engineering, you're paying much more attention. We'll have an example of it, that you're paying attention to the individual details. Motorola was one of the first companies to get into pre-control very extensively for all key operations. And one of the Motorola engineers whose name I've got on the slide here.
What's that, Wisher?
Yeah, Wisherette. He decided to do something rather original, which I had never thought of. He watched an operator at this operation of Motorola and semiconductor work in a furnace, and he watched that the operator went out of control on an X bar and R chart about eight or nine times during the 8-hour shift, and each time he had to make an adjustment. But when you make an adjustment, you don't know where the new control limits are.
That's right. Absolutely.
And therefore, you got the wrong control limits, and it's called hunting, because 50% of the time you adjust too much, 50% of the time too short.
Mm-hmm.
Pre-control avoids that by the rule shown on the right of this particular slide that you have in front of you, which is you must get 5 consecutive parts in the green area to show that the adjustment had not been too large or too small. He made a histogram of the material for the first shift and then came back the very next morning with a repeat of that shift the next day. Mm-hmm. It takes 10 minutes to teach somebody how to read colors and count to 2 and 5. And notice the histogram. The hunting has multiple peaks and an inflated process capability. The same exact operation, same process, same operator. You got one peak, you got a narrower distribution, because this is a setup rule that's very, very important in pre-control that makes a big difference in the results. And people, operators, like it because they get an immediate feedback. They know when they've over-adjusted or under-adjusted and can take immediate action. I'm recommending on this slide, it's so simple that you actually try it tomorrow in your plant, or actually, what is this? No, yeah, this is Monday,
yeah,
so
sure,
that's good. You could try it tomorrow. And we've given you a set of rules to supplement this sort of a thing.
Let me ask you a question, Dorian.
Go ahead.
Approximately what year was this? Somewhere in the 50s?
Yeah, 1952, we did this with Jones and Lamson Machine Company, mm-hmm. Springfield, Vermont. They wanted to be able to use their shadow graphs and just count where the shadow was in the center mm-hmm. target area zone. No calculations, no numbers to write down, no control charts.
And so you went about devising this pre-control methodology. Is that right?
Yeah. There were 3 of us working with me
yeah.
as a team at Rath and Strong under contract with Jones and Lamson Machine Company.
How did you decide on the proportions here, like half red?
That was through a Monte Carlo simulation.
Oh, I've because always wondered about
that. We don't
that.
Have normal distributions.
Yeah.
We got distributions that are skewed. We got distributions. By the way, you realize it's impossible to have a normal distribution because our factories don't go from minus infinity to plus infinity for our fabricating equipment. All tales of statistical distribution, believe me, are truncated, cut off somewhere. And they sometimes have multiple peaks, bimodal, sometimes skewed, as I said earlier, and so on. And so we had to use Monte Carlo simulation to get the right proper balance
mm-hmm.
between 2 kinds of risks, a risk of making a change when you shouldn't and a risk of not making a change when you should.
I've often wondered, where those proportions came from.
Oh, yeah. We just couldn't have a theoretical model. We mm-hmm. had to do it with Monte Carlo simulation. With computers, it really helped us a great deal. Okay. So please try it.
Something you said made me think of a book I may write one day called Tales of Statistical Distributions.
Okay, I like that.
Yeah?
Tales.
Yeah.
Motorola was the very large activity and did amazing results, just like those first 2 case histories we showed you. In the semiconductor business, where the yields are typically 35-40% good semiconductor chips,
mm-hmm.
this has been going on company after company, year after year. Motorola, using pre-control and some of these other analytical techniques that I'm going to be telling you more about, actually made 2.1 million semiconductors at a Austin, Texas plant as a trial, not a single one out of spec, unheard of.
Amazing.
And Keke Bolt, working at Motorola, has given us this quotation that you can read about how these techniques have done a far superior job with their own teams and people. Here's a screw products company. We've got an article in Modern Machine Shop that I've given you a reference in the appendix, and I recommend you all get a copy of it if you can. And they made, for the Ford Motor Company, way back in the 1960s, using pre-control, 30 million parts on a 6-spindle Brown and Sharp screw machine with an impossible tolerance to hold and not a single one out of spec. They had to hold that tight tolerance for a half-inch long body. Everybody knew automatic screw machines couldn't do it. But you remember those 2 histograms we mm-hmm. showed you? The process capability is narrowed as you avoid the hunting.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, the textbook approach, and I grew up with X-bar and R charts. I had 400 of them going.
Hell, I got an X-bar and R ranch. I told you about
that. There you go. People don't realize that, unfortunately, that's an inherent characteristic of having to work for a period of time with the wrong control limits
mm-hmm.
because you need 25 subgroups to find out where they
should be shifted. Well, you're a statistical controller now. Yeah.
So you can get some amazing, dramatic results, as is shown there. Here is a list of all 30 of the techniques And it takes the six-day seminar to really understand them, which precedes the practice that follows. And I'm going to be taking up one of them. I've got an arrow on here. Because we've had, again, some very dramatic stories in my favorite profession of aeronautical engineering. Pratt & Whitney Aircraft has developed a rocket engine, liquid oxygen hydrogen engine, second stage engine called the RL-10 for NASA. And it takes things out of Earth orbit and puts them out beyond Earth orbit like we had to do to go to the moon. And they've had 128 second stage firings. The report I had several years ago, not a single one failed. NASA finally admitted at that time, which was back in the 1960s, that that was the most reliable rocket engine they had. And how did we do it? We forced failures on prototypes to find out where we had insufficient margin of safety. We got to know where that weakest tail of strength is and the highest tail of stress. And as engineers, you know, anytime stress equals strength or stress is greater, something's going to go.
That's right.
And we got to have that margin of safety, and that's really what we've done with this technique. Now, you've all been hearing, and we still hear it today on the news, about the F-16
mm-hmm.
Mach 2.5 supersonic fighter that the Air Force has. And the F-16 actually has only one of these Pratt & Whitney F-100 jet engines. The previous one that McDonnell Douglas had two of the F-100s. So if you had any trouble with one, you could still get to Edwards Air Force Base or Nettles or something safely. But the General Dynamics one only had one engine, and they were concerned about whether they should continue up beyond the prototype mm-hmm. stage, because they had a characteristic just like you have with cars. If you're going up a hill and you really step on accelerator, and the engine just doesn't have the ability, it'll stall mm-hmm. to take that load. And the same thing will happen in maneuvers in the air. And usually when a jet engine stalls, you can point the nose down and get it restarted. Some of the F-16s with F-100 Pratt & Whitney engines had this characteristic called stall, slant, stagnation. You couldn't start, restart it.
Boy, that'll ruin your day.
And a Mach 2.5 fighter with no power is not a very good glider,
right.
Unfortunately.
An opportunity to test the eject system.
So the Pratt & Whitney three-person team, using these techniques, the two axioms and the process of elimination, found two separate variables that interacted. Now, interaction is a synergistic thing. That means you don't get the total effect equal to the sum of the parts. It's greater than the sum of the parts. And an engineering change made some years ago earlier on the nose intake on the F-100 jet engine and the afterburner section was interacting. Nobody had a way of discovering it
mm-hmm.
until we used what we call component search patterns. And it's a very, very rapidly converging process of elimination. I'd like to just give you a little bit of that as we go along to show you that there's very great logic behind all of these techniques. Each one of these had to be discovered because it was a real necessity. That made inventors out of us.
Yeah, so no single technique is a panacea. It's not
right.
going to solve all your problems.
Now, there are 9 different clue generators.
Yeah, I noticed
that.
I wanted to ask you about that.
Yeah, I've got them marked with numbers on here.
Okay, the ones that are not clue generators, what are those?
After you get the clue, like the designed experiments mm-hmm. and so forth, you follow on and narrow down the process of elimination further.
Okay, so those are problem-solving techniques, whereas 1 through 9 are the generators of the clues to identify the red X's and the pink X's, etc.
To converge upon the unknown, the unexpected.
Okay.
You got it.
Okay.
Yep.
Just want to make sure I understood.
Yep. Now here's component search patterns. This goes back to a very interesting necessity we had from Vickers, the division of Sperry Rand, and it was exactly 20 years after I got my degree because my classmate, Ben Badenoch, was engineering manager mm-hmm. of Vickers division of Sperry Rand, and this 40-part pump designed for Cessnas and Beechcrafts, they tried to meet they had a requirement of output of a minimum of 5 gallons per minute hydraulic output, and 70% of their product for about 5 years met that requirement. 30% had not, as you see on one of these, we're only getting 4 gallons a minute output. So the repair people have to tear it down and take a look to see if they can find something interfering, scuffed, or a malformed gasket or something that went wrong, put in replacement parts, try it again, and that repair work was really basically taking their profit away. And Ben, when he had me over there, said, I wonder, Dorian, if we can't take two units, only two, one that is good and one that fails to meet the requirement, and if we can get the right part and swap the parts, could we make the 4 gallons move with part C over here and the 6 gallons with part C here, and if it seems to reverse, put them back where they are, show that we can turn it on and off. Is that possible to develop some kind
of... That's an intelligent question.
However, while I said it's not impossible, with 40 parts, the number of new assemblies I can make just using the components of here, having no two alike, is 2 to the 40th power, which is 1,099,511. Guy wouldn't live long enough to be able to go through the entire thing.
That's kind of a consultant's guarantee of lifetime employment.
There you go. So we developed this component search patterns, which is a process of elimination. The point I want to make through here is that when you swap one part, and you learn about this in the 6-day seminar, and neither the 6 nor the 4 change when you swap, it's not a member of an interaction red X, it's not a member of a separate main effect.
Right.
That means you don't have 40 parts anymore, you have only 39. So that one swap under our technique here has eliminated one half of 1,099,000,000,000. It's amazing how many X's you can get rid of.
That's a fair contribution.
Oh, it's a tremendously, and you do this step by step. You usually end up with about 12 to 16 swaps with only 2 prototypes, very effective in R&D work before you even get into production, to be able to find which parts have somewhere a red X in them. And once you got it down to the 2 parts that are causing it, you can make the comparisons to really see what's going on.
You know, I need to point out to our audience that we've got about just under 3 minutes left, about 2.5 minutes before we take our break, and we'll have about a 10-minute break before we come back. We haven't had any questions yet, and I know that Dorian and I would both enjoy the opportunity, if you'd like to call in during the break or call in after the break during the telecast, we'll get you on the air if you'd like, or if you prefer not, just send us a fax, we'll read your question and try and respond to you. You know, this is a very expensive guy we got right here. You know, he charges a bundle. He's worth every penny, but he charges a bundle. This is your opportunity for, you know, virtually no cost at all, except the time of a and cost of a phone call or a fax, to call in and ask a question or questions relative to a problem or problems that you've got in your organization. Well, having said that, we've got about 1.5 minutes left, so Dorian, go ahead, and then I'll cut you off.
Explain, we don't do any marketing or advertising.
You don't have to.
Because one executive talks to another executive, word of mouth, but I think if I start a marketing department, Jack, I'm going to put you
on. Okay.
You did a very good job. I just wanted very, very briefly, and I apologize because it takes much more than just this brief introduction.
Yeah, but we're strictly an overview.
Yeah, there's a tremendous power to the combination of the two axioms and what I learned from Arthur Conan Doyle, a fiction story writer. Well, let's see what we have next here. I guess we ought to, this is an actual implant case history on a jet engine fuel control, and I'd like to compare the present statistical quality control management approach to problem solving with what we've done with one of our clue generators called a multi-vari chart, and I'm sure that will follow our break.
Okay.
But what I'd like to do is start our discussion by using that actual case history from Connecticut, a Connecticut company. And it shows a very dramatic difference in results that you would get.
Okay, well, this would probably be a good point to break then. So what I'll do is I'll say that we'll be back in about 10 minutes. At that time, Dorian and I will continue talking about statistical engineering and how it can solve virtually any problem that you've got in your manufacturing area or help you to design new products or processes. And so we'll see you in about 10 minutes. Take care, do what you need to do, and...
Let's hear from you.
Yeah, let's hear from you is right. Yeah. Calls and faxes. Hi, we're back with part two of Continuous Improvement Television. I'm Jack ReVelle, here today with my guest Dorian Shainin. Before we continue with this second half of today's broadcast, October 10th, 1994, I wanted to take just a moment aside to say my congratulations to the Hughes-Tucson team, the Hughes Missile Systems Company, of which I'm a part. I wanted to offer my congratulations publicly to our team that won the Arizona State Quality Award. I'll see all, or many of you, tomorrow in Phoenix at the Governor's Banquet and Award Conference and Awards Banquet, at which time our President, Dave McPherson, will be accepting the Governor's Award for Quality from Governor Fife Symington. And I want you to know how enthusiastic, to use your word, how enthusiastic I am about the fact that first time out of the chute, Hughes Missile Systems Company showed what it was made of, and we won the Arizona State Quality Award. So guys, gals, good job, and I look forward to seeing you tomorrow.
Yep. My congratulations, too.
And we'll do better even next year when we've got Dorian helping us. Okay?
Right.
Okay, now, during the break, I'm told that we had a phone call. The gentleman said he was going to call back during the actual telecast because he had a question about slide number 18, the one that Dorian was talking about, the rapidly converging process of elimination. I don't guess the gentleman has called back yet. They haven't notified me from the control that he's gone back. So why don't we, Dorian, continue on until such time as our caller gets back on the air for us. In the meantime, don't forget, anybody who would like to call or fax in their questions, that's what we're here for. Go ahead, Dorian, and I'll just back off here.
You see here a cylindrical rotor shaft, which is a component of the jet engine fuel control, and they had a tolerance on the diameter so that it could rotate nicely and freely of a quarter of an inch plus or minus a thousandth. And it's an 8-year-old lathe that turns the outside diameter here. It needed a paint job. It made noises. They couldn't hold the tolerance. And the manufacturing vice president got a little annoyed with that because he said, one of the four fundamentals of quality is conformance to requirements. And how come you guys in manufacturing are not conforming to the plus or minus a thousandth? You know, if you go to engineering and you ask for more tolerance, the answer you usually get is, I give you guys 2.54 centimeters. You always seem to take 1.6 kilometers. You learn how to speak metric. But anyway, the answer is usually no. It won't work well if because of tolerance accumulations and so on. We got to hold the plus or minus a thousandth. Well, one of the manufacturing engineers got brave enough to tell his vice president in charge, he says, if you guys put your money where your mouth is and buy us a lathe that has the process capability that meets the requirement, well, we'll meet the requirement. So they ran a process capability study. Did you want to interrupt?
Yeah, I'm told that the gentleman who called during the break is back on the phone now. Go ahead.
Yes, Dorian, what I wanted to know was you have an arrow pointing to whether you distinguish there's a problem with a component or during assembly.
Right.
So how do you tell when you're switching parts back and forth between these two?
We do that by tear down and rebuild before the interchanging and measure to see whether or not we get repeatable results. If we don't get repeatable results on tear down and rebuild without any swapping, that means alignments, torques, activities, gaskets, things like this are possibly having this red X in them. On the other hand, if we get a separation of 4 gallons and 6 gallons, it stays on tear down and rebuild, and we have to do it 3 times, actually, not a very big sample, in order to know with 95% confidence that we've got the red X either in the assembly activities or in the parts themselves. That's the first separation. Just like on a dictionary, as we say on a slide, if you say to somebody when you open the dictionary, in the middle is the secret word you picked on the left or the right of the open dictionary, you've eliminated half the dictionary when you get a yes or no answer. It's very similar to that, process of elimination.
Would our caller like to identify himself?
Yes, Raymond from from IBM in Burlington, Vermont.
Ah, terrific. Thank you very much. Does Dorian need to pursue this further? I guess not.
Okay. Good.
I guess that wavering signal indicates that he's hung up, and so hopefully that's another success for Dorian Shainin. Okay, well, hopefully that took care of it. Let's continue on now on slide 19.
As you can see from this process capability study with Air Canada pointing to it, we have tails of a distribution which are below the low limit and above the high limit. And that's what the manufacturing engineer wanted his vice president boss to get, was a lathe with a new lathe with a process capability that could meet the requirement.
That's an expensive item.
Well, they went ahead and they made inquiries and got the new lathe manufacturers to quote on it. And in those early days, I was only there about 2 days at the time, starting an assignment with this company. And I went into the purchasing manager's office to work with, through him, through purchasing to a supplier of another part that they had, and found out they were going to buy this lathe that they found that using an amortization procedure that you learn as an accountant, you might say, or a master of business administration, you could get a savings by not having the scrap and rework with a $70,000 investment, and they were going to invest in better quality by getting a new modern lathe that would do the job.
On the surface, that sounds like it almost made sense.
Yeah, and they used an X bar and R chart in order to get the process capability and so forth, you see here. And of course, my request was to the purchasing manager, could you hold that purchase order till about noon tomorrow? And he says, why do you want to do that? Well, I said, I want to see if we can find this thing called a Red X. I explained Pareto to the purchasing manager, things are not equal. There's a Red X in there that's a leading one. Mm-hmm. And if I can find that before noon tomorrow, maybe we don't have to buy the new lathe, you see. He says, we know what the Red X is. I said, you do? Yeah. He says, the Red X is worn bushings and spindles. The manufacturing people have been running this lathe for about 8 years. That's their daily activity, 8 hours a day for all this period of time. And they said, it's got worn bushings and spindles. That's the Red X. Well, I said, it could be. But, you know, it could be something else. There are hundreds and hundreds of possible X's. He said, what else could it possibly be, you know, challenging me? Because he said the experts, the manufacturing people know it's worn bushings and spindles. Well, I said, suppose we spend the $70,000. We get the new lathe in here. We want to run some trial pieces. But we can't. We don't have the collet, the holding fixture for this. But we still have it on the old lathe. It's interchangeable. So we take the collet holding fixture from the old lathe, put it on the new one, run some pieces, and by God, we don't have plus or minus 8/10 the salesman promised us. We still have over 2,000 variation. Somebody would then say, hey, you used the collet from the old lathe. Let's take a look at it. Well, the fingers that close in on the part, designed for this part, let's say I told the purchasing manager, suppose I find a little metal burr there that's interfering with proper closing. I take a hand file. With one swipe of the file, I get rid of the burr. It costs us $70,000 to find that damn burr on there. He said, I hope it's not going to be that. I said, no, you just asked me for an example. I don't know what it is, but we'll find out. And so now we'll take you from ordinary statistical process control with X bar and R charts and so on into the process of elimination and show you that basically what you've got to do is redefine that Red X. Because if you don't find the Red X, it's still in there in the shop. Its effect is magnified by the square root of the sum of the squares, and it'll continue to cause trouble. So we plan our dividing of total variation into separate families in a thing called a solution tree. And to do that, we have to measure our parts, talk to the parts, as it were. And so if you go on to the next slide, here's how we talk to the rotor shafts. We take one rotor shaft at 8 o'clock in the morning, and we take a dial indicator or a micrometer, and we don't just get one measurement on four parts and get an average and range as we do with control charts. Notice, everybody, we take four measurements on one part. Greater detail. Quite a difference in working with averages. And we rotate the part because it may not be circular on the left side. We move our measuring device to the right side, rotate it. four measurements, A, B, C, and D. By this strategy, which is not really too complicated, we've really, on a piece of graph paper, can now divide total variation into how much variation we have within the part, the second section on the same graph, on the multivari chart, how much variation do we have on consecutive parts, part to part, and you must keep the manufacturing sequence, and you only need 3 to 5 consecutive parts, and then hour to hour, how much difference we have time to time. So this multivari chart shows a four-sided figure, A, B, C, D, showing on a scale of diameter the outer round on the left side, the outer round on the right side. Left to right, the slanting line is taper. And we see that from the tolerance, plus or minus a thousandth, we're using up about half of the tolerance on within-piece variation, single pieces. The little darker line connecting the center of this area to the center of that to the center of that is the consecutive piece-to-piece variation, using up only about 5% of the total. But hour to hour as we come back, this is not a random sample, ladies and gentlemen. It's a stratified sample. And the hour to hour shows we're using up more than the tolerance. So all we know is, and that, this is rather interesting in a new paradigm shift, you're not trying to identify the family that has the largest variation. Take a note. We're trying to get rid of, eliminate the impossible. At the moment, the within piece and piece to piece are not the largest. They don't have a red X. Within piece may have a pink X. But the red X is something changing with time. So immediately the foreman, who knew that management had authorized the new lays, and he wanted it, he could smell it. He wanted the lays so badly. He said, Mr. Shainin, he said, see, it's like a sawtooth. It comes down, up, down, up. And he said, that's as a result of the worn bushings and spindles causing vibration, so the cutting edge of the tool is going dull, and the operator has to put a new tool, resharpened. I said, look, as you stand on the shop floor, you see the tool comes into the outside diameter of the rotating piece, traverses from one end to another. And so if it was tool wear, as he was proposing, the diameter should get bigger with time, not smaller.
That's right.
I'm sorry, I said, but the process of elimination.
Nice try, it didn't work.
No, it didn't work, exactly. And so you can begin to see that you're getting a message. And here is the solution tree we talked about. The problem, the Y, is the diameter, because the next operation is the customer of that part. And we have divided up with a multivari chart, as you just saw, the total variation into three families. We eliminate, like Sherlock Holmes, cross out the two things that don't have the largest variation. We cannot eliminate time to time. But we do have some other clues. You may have noticed, not only is the direction of change ruling out tool wear as a time thing, but also there was a big change from 10 o'clock in the morning to 11, if we put that back on for a moment. And that was not when they put a resharpened tool in. That was a coffee break. For 20 minutes, that machine was down, cooling off.
So it's like a temperature thing.
So temperature fits.
Is that right? Did I guess right?
Yep. But you needed the clues.
Yeah, that's right.
The direction of change means that when parts, steel parts, are going through a temperature change,
they're expanding.
They're expanding, and the longer parts expand more with a constant coefficient of thermal expansion than the shorter parts do. That changes the distance from the cutting edge to the axis of the piece.
Of course.
That could fit. And the big change when it cools down and it starts warming up again. So I asked the foreman, how could we check the theory it could be temperature? Can we turn it on and off? He said, let's see how much coolant there is in the tank. We take the cast iron cover off the coolant tank. The manufacturer has a mark in there, the lathe manufacturer. Keep your coolant level up to this mark. Ladies and gentlemen, would you believe it? The coolant was below the mark. $4 worth of coolant, and the trouble disappeared. Go lower on the coolant, you get back into it.
Oh, my Lord.
And set a $70,000 in less than a day. We got half of that variation. Running a process capability is obsolete. People still do it, but you don't need to do that. Instead, do a multi-vari investigation. Only took 15 parts. And you could see the message coming right at you, a clue, a couple of clues as to what's doing it.
That's amazing.
The taper, always in the same direction if you look at that multivari chart, 15 times in a row. You stand by the lathe, you see the tool traverses as the part rotates. So obviously, the guide rail for the cutting edge of the tool is not parallel to the axis of the piece. That didn't take long to straighten out. Mm-hmm. And the outer round, we put a crayon mark on the collet, so we transferred it to the piece. And all those A's you see, let's go to back to that last chart. All those A's were at 630 on the rotation. And so we got a larger diameter at 630 than smaller, larger. Eccentric bearing. Fixed a one eccentric bearing, made the path of the guide rail of the tool parallel to the axis of the piece, kept the coolant level up. I was there. Plus or minus 0.2. All in one day, we got rid of 80% of that process capability, and we never had to buy the new equipment. I hate to tell you how many corporations and companies invest in new manufacturing equipment, not realizing
prematurely
the real, that's right, prematurely, because they got a theory, the theory sounds right, but they have not turned it on and off.
Now, this kind of thing that you're showing us, I can see applies very nicely in mechanical operations. I know for a fact, because I've experienced it using multivari, that it works in electrical operations.
Yes.
For example, we were making use Fullerton circuit cards, and this is before surface mount technology. We were taking and putting in the electrical leads in the in the circuit cards, and then running the circuit cards through the liquid solder.
Yep.
And using multivari, we discovered that the problem had nothing to do with the wave solder machine, you know, the excess problems that we were running with defects. The problem was that the frames that we were using to move the boards into the machine had warped.
There you go.
And we identified that using through a multivari approach.
Music to my ears.
I knew it would be.
That's the way it ought to be.
That's
every
right.
time. Nothing happens without a reason, and that reason can be found.
Yep.
Provided you start not making a list of what you think it is,
yeah.
get clues instead. You're right.
Beautiful.
Terrific.
But I just wanted to point that out to our viewing audience.
Back to a reminder about Sherlock Holmes.
Yeah.
On a solution tree, don't try to find where you're going to be looking. Instead, get rid of things that can't be, and you have a rapidly converging process of elimination right down to the bitter end, which is that single red X every
Amazing.
Time. Yep. Here we go.
Super.
Now here is the B versus C. The basic, can we separate? Is it the assembly and disassembly, or is it the parts that we had on that earlier slide?
You want to tell everybody what B versus C stands for?
B stands for better after you've made a change. C stands for current, before.
Okay.
You have a scale of quality here. Worse on the left, better on the right. And if you got the wrong X, not the red one, the blue one, the new distribution after you change the blue one is identical virtually to the old one. And we have, if you're taking notes, a hypothesis statistically called the null, N-U-L-L hypothesis. And we're comparing results before the change C, after the change B, have we got a red X? If we do, with the square root of the sum of the squares, 5-1 becoming 25-1, you get a separation.
Mm-hmm.
And when you put things in not the variable data or the attribute data characteristics that we're so familiar with, but instead a new kind of statistical measure called rank order data, that means the B's will all rank higher on the best to the second best to the third compared to the three C's. We call it a six-pack test. Three buds and three cores.
I knew you were going to say something like that.
And we can separate the whether or not we have found the red X or not by this little simple rank order test.
And if you do enough six-pack tests, you don't care if the experiment fails.
Right. Here is a thing called, which is a very, very important part of this new paradigm shift, working with small samples called sample space. Sample space shows every possible outcome, barring none. and it comes from using something you learned in high school. How many different combinations of n things can you get r at a time? Maybe you remember combinations and
permutations.
Right. This is not permutations. This is combinations. So in rank order, the best result, second to the best, third. If the distributions are separated, as shown at the bottom of the previous slide, the three B's done in random sequence will always end up the top three.
Gotcha.
Separate from the bottom. But there are 19 other ways it could possibly happen from the null hypothesis.
Mm-hmm.
19 times out of 20 is 95%.
That's right.
So when you have the null hypothesis, you are protected against a wrong conclusion 19 times out of 20. When you do have the red X, the only possibility is getting that particular order that we see there. No overlap of ranks. And so in the 20, in the 6-day seminar, you end up learning what we call end count that we got from the head of the statistics work at Princeton University, John Tukey, in a paper he wrote way back in the 50s. He was the giant, and I liked standing on his shoulders because it has worked out beautifully. It's a very quick way to be able to demonstrate the fact that the clues are being interpreted properly.
You know, I noticed that you're mentioning here on the slide, and you have it here with you, a 20-faced fair die. Did you want to mention about that?
And here is a picture of an icosahedron die, little triangular faces, all symmetrical.
Let's see if we can get it over here in the center.
If it's a fair die, the probability of any one of these numbers coming up is exactly 1 in 20, provided we understand you must get your data in random sequence. And I like to use that die to show it's just logic, common sense. You don't have to be a PhD in statistics to understand.
Thank God I'm not a PhD in statistics. It's industrial engineering.
There you go. So I use devices like that in the six-day seminar to really show people.
Mm-hmm.
We call it the KISS system, K-I-S-S. Write it down. Stands for keep it statistically simple. We leave out the word stupid.
You know, you mentioned that to me earlier, and I was going to mention to you, and I forgot to. You could also call it keep it statistically significant.
You're right.
Because
keep
that's
the odds definitely in your favor.
Yeah.
Yep. And 95 to 5. In fact, we have a whole table in the 6-day seminar of 5% risk, which is this one, 1/10 of 1% risk, and 1/10 of 1% risk. And by the way, if you want a confidence of 3 9s with only 1 chance in 1,000 of being wrong, it only takes a sample of 6 Bs and 6 Cs, which is not very large. Total of only 12. But you have to make them the two different ways,
of course,
in random sequence to guarantee that each one has an equally likely opportunity to occur under the null hypothesis.
Gotcha.
Okay.
Good. Okay.
Okay, now, I thought it would be interesting to get to another case history on lead frame stamping, where as you know, when you make a semiconductor, you've got to have leads coming in and leads going out, and there's a steel little frame that's stamped out, and they wanted to, before the dies had to be resharpened at this particular company, they had 28 of these punch presses. This is in Massachusetts, and to be competitive, they had to run at a fairly high speed. And they were always having damaged dies and chipped dies, and long before they got to their goal to be competitive, which they needed 2 million stamped out lead frames before they wanted to resharpen the dies. And they measured everything in K number of lead frames, K being 1,000 of them. Their goal is 2,000 K before they have to resharpen a die, and for 3 years, they couldn't get a single one of the 28 dies to do the job. And I had a day to spend with them and would be able, my first free day after that was 2 weeks later. They took data that they kept for over 3 years on every run of every one of the 28 dies, operators, repairmen, numbers. What are they looking for? Yeah, before they wrote that memo, they're looking for a Pareto distribution, which they thought they would show, find the leading one.
Mm-hmm.
It came out there was no Pareto distribution. That's another slide I used in the 6-day seminar. Everything came out equal. And that means they really have missed the red X.
That's right.
It's not random, it's not equal. And so what we had to do basically was get another clue. And I think it was Yogi Berra of the New York Yankees who once said, you can see a lot by looking. So we stood there for 15 minutes watching 28 punch presses, and I saw the way they were tightening the four nuts on the four clamps that held the bottom die on the bolster plate. They would do it very, very lightly, and they never went clockwise or counterclockwise. They went diagonally, and it was explained to me, if you tighten them, first finger tight, then hand tight, then with a wrench, tighter and tighter, you get a creeping of the alignment of the die on the base plate to that in the plunger. And so they learned years ago never to tighten clockwise or counterclockwise, but instead go corner to corner on these four. Well, being an engineer, knowing threads like a mechanical advantage, mm-hmm. and when you do it hand tight, you don't know whether the real tension that you put in each of these four clamps is going to be equal or not. Anybody got a torque wrench around here? 20 minutes later, they found a torque wrench, so we could set the needle to get more closely the same tightening on all four, and that did show, as that memo shows from the company, they found they got a clear difference on B versus C testing. So here are the six rungs, mm-hmm. done in random order, as you see on the left here, and you see the dates, and you see the results they got in so many K. And much to everybody's surprise, the last one, which was a B, and you see there was no overlap when you put them in rank order, best, second best down to the worst, and you see the best one they had didn't quite make the 2,000 K, but they got awful close. Best result they had in over 3 years. So that, as the memo says, get rid of the clamps, get rid of the nuts that you tighten, and have dowels to locate the bottom die so it can't possibly rotate. And every run they had after that simple change was over 2 million, still making them competitively compared to the company in West Germany that was their biggest competitor. And it, again, just took a B versus mm-hmm. C to say you got it or you
That's
haven't
great.
Got it.
You mentioned here, and I think some of the audience might, who are not necessarily practicing statisticians, mm-hmm. might be interested in knowing why it was necessary to do these trials in random order.
That's because the red X could be in one of the hundreds of thousands of X's, mm-hmm. and it'll guarantee 19 times out of 20 not to separate. You'll get an overlap of B's and C's in rank order.
And what happened if you didn't do it in random order?
Then you could be the victim of anything else associated. Mm-hmm. Did you know statistics show that more people die in bed than any other place? Stay the hell out of bed, it's dangerous.
Oh.
Well, we laugh at that because we know damn well going to bed didn't cause the death. But it's highly associated on a correlation plot.
There's a similar one that I think 90 or 95% of all auto accidents occur within 25 miles of a person's home.
There you go.
I used to think that was very impressive until I realized that most people did all their driving there.
There you go.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you come to the six-day seminar, I got another one that is not quite as polite, but we'll have to hold that one for the six-day seminar.
Speaking of Yogi Berra, as you did a moment ago, one of my favorite Yogi Berra-isms is when you come to the fork in the road, take it.
Yep. Or they compare a Yogi Maharaj in New Delhi, India, mm-hmm. with the same question they asked Berra.
Mm-hmm.
And Maharaja was asked, what time is it? Gave a very philosophical answer. The time is now, and now is the time. They asked Berra, what time is it? He says, you mean now? Go ahead.
Okay, let's move on before somebody starts throwing punches here.
Now, as an introduction under the KISS system, the design of experiments, which is one of our 30 mm-hmm. techniques, using what you just learned, rank order analysis, not F tables, not ratios of error variance compared to the variance you get from level to level. You can have here two variables, A and B, three levels of each.
Mm-hmm.
One can be three levels of temperature within your operating range in the factory, three levels of pressure, or whatever the suspected variables. Clues give you the, by the way, most designed experiments, the variables are not picked with clues. They're picked from expert opinions.
That's right.
Which unfortunately
absolutely true.
Turn out not to be the red X so often. So instead we have the clue generation from two or more of those nine clue generators mm-hmm. I showed you earlier marked. And from that, we have as good candidates for the red X, either A alone, B alone, or some combination interacting. And we have 9 combination intersections that we can run as a designed experiment. If we neglected an important one like B in the three-dimensional picture, we would get the results, these Y bars going up into what is called a response surface, and they would show scatter as you projected the 9 unequal results.
Mm-hmm.
But you have to go back and randomize and do it a second time to see good repeatability.
Right.
Again, if you don't get good repeatability within the 9 test combinations, the thing that's causing it is an unknown red X, and you've missed it.
Right.
So you know that early. But if you get good repeatability in these unequal 9 lines,
you can be
right. You got it.
Yeah.
And so this is what we have to do. I've given you a list of some of the assumptions that are made in designed experiments and analysis of variance, which unfortunately are not supported consistently in the real world. We've avoided that by going to rank order. We don't assume a normal distribution. We don't assume a zero mean for the error. And that has made a real big difference in results. Now, you notice we have curved lines
mm-hmm.
here called the elements of the response surface. If I take a sheet of paper from a pad, the ruled lines, we call it ruled, they're parallel to each other. And I can have A and B, so I could have an A effect this way, a B effect this way.
Could you hold a little further away from you? Now we can get it. So I'm just trying to get under the camera.
And you can have a slope this way, a slope that way, that's a main effect.
Mm-hmm.
You could have a gradual curve this way. As long as these lines are all parallel to each other,
mm-hmm.
you have no interaction.
Yeah, I was just looking at it in the camera here to make sure that the audience could see what you're doing.
Okay.
So now you can see how it's changed.
In order to get an interaction, you've got to twist that response surface. So if I take this,
mm-hmm.
if I can still see it here, and twist it, I rotate the lines one to another.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the lines going out of parallel that is the strength of the interaction. And those 9 intersections are the 9 test combinations you
mm-hmm.
see here in what we call a full factorial design, where every possible one of these 9 combinations is there. The numbers are the random sequence. You come back to that same spot later on at random. Mm-hmm. If you get the same result, the A and B have an influence,
gotcha.
Red X influence. If you don't get the same result, poor repeatability. It's one of the unknown variables that's causing that lack of repeatability.
Gotcha.
And unfortunately, as you get more and more variables, the experiment gets so big, it's been very popular around the world to go into a fraction of all the combinations. And unfortunately, you have aliases, multiple names. There's no way to separate truly what's happening.
That's true.
So we say in fractional factorials, let's assume, and that's another bad practice,
mm-hmm.
as we all know, that it's not going to be an interaction. And interactions can be very important, as you see.
In fact, if I recall from when I first met you back in 1988, I heard you say something that the interactions can sometimes be far more important than the main effects themselves.
Exactly. On the real unsolvable problems, Jack, almost always, not always, but almost always, the red X is an interaction. 2-factor, 3-factor.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, I found 3 5-factor interactions in many years that turned out to be the red X. Nobody could have discovered it. One was a chemical process, another was the heat treating of steel,
mm-hmm.
and another one was, of all things, the manufacture of professional golf balls to keep them close to a sphere.
Mm-hmm.
You have no trouble on the equator diameter on golf balls. Keep them within about a plus or minus 1,000. But the north to south pole varies about 12,000ths on typical golf balls.
And you said these were 5-factor interactions?
5-factor.
Nobody in the world would have guessed those. That's no subject matter expert in the world would have possibly said, well, if you take these 5 factors, the interaction between them is what's causing our problem.
You have to discover it. And that's what we have with our rank order analysis of designed experiments. Using full factorials, not fractional
mm-hmm.
factorials. And that's part of the oncoming revolution, I'm quite sure. Because you notice with that component search patterns,
mm-hmm.
the full factorial would have had 1,099,000,000,000,000 combinations. We narrowed it down into about 16 steps by eliminating, cutting things
mm-hmm.
called binary search, just like a spell checker does with modern software. Mm-hmm. Cut it in half, cut them in half again, it's a very rapidly converging thing that'll find that red X every time. That's how we find the five-factor interactions.
That's amazing.
And it really works. It's really worthwhile getting your team to understand how this operates.
The first time you used that many years ago, I'm sure it must have been quite a revelation to you to see the power that you held in your hands.
Well, yeah, you get the first idea, then you have to refine it.
Mm-hmm.
Then you have to turn it on and off, make some more changes,
yeah.
Turn it on, and then you get it.
Fascinating.
It usually takes a week or two to develop a new technique.
A week or two. Oh.
Go ahead.
That's talk about guruism.
Now, here's one you can all practice with at home. Here we have good repeatability within these experiments. And we have here the results. And you can almost, by eyeballing, you don't really have to do much. You can see the element rising from 3 to 4 to 5 as A goes from the low level onto the high level.
Mm-hmm.
This is parallel at level B2. This is parallel. So we have three lines going parallel.
Lots of consistency
no
there.
No interaction. You can look at it vertically. You notice they go two units up as you go down,
right.
In parallel. So this is a picture of the red X and the pink X can be picked out of here.
And those are averages as we go across here, and those are averages
as
we go down
correct.
There.
And we say here, don't pay any attention to the averages. This is so important in the new paradigm. Pay attention to the difference between 5 and 6. That's 1. The difference between 6 and 7. That's 1.
Okay, so that's the difference in the averages.
And that's only coming from A. B is not held constant.
Right.
But there's no B effect in the differences. What B has done is it's raised all three or lowered all three because B contributed the same amount.
Exactly.
That came from the work of Sir Ronald Fisher, the father of designed experiments in the UK.
Back in the 1920s.
Yeah, 1920s, and it's still good.
And by the way, folks, we're going to have his former son-in-law, Dr. George Box is our guest next June, talking about the classical approach to design of experiments. Just
right.
Thought I'd mention that.
Notice the difference vertically to show the here the effect of B independent of A is basically 2 units. So the candidate for the red X is B, the candidate for the pink X is A, and the interaction, A-B interaction, is 0 because they're running parallel.
Right.
The thing that we have to teach the people ready to go through the paradigm shift is that basically if you take two numbers or more that are not alike and you add a constant to them or you subtract a constant, you don't change the differences. 10 and 12 have a difference of 2. Add 5 to both, you get 15 and 17, the difference is still 2. That simple concept is what Sir Ronald Fisher used.
Mm-hmm.
Even though you can't hold things constant, his work in agriculture and in human genetics, you can't hold things constant. He can neutralize, separate what's happening. Now this second picture here shows, again, 3, 4, 5 rising an element, just as we did above. But notice the next element is not parallel, it's horizontal, and this one goes down. This is a twisted response surface. There's an A-B interaction here. And you can see it by eyeballing, parallel, non-parallel. As you take your averages, this is exciting. The differences are 0.
Wow.
The differences are 0. A doesn't do anything alone. B doesn't do anything alone.
But together.
Together, they interact. That's called a synergistic result. The total effect is greater than 0 plus 0.
See, I would call that the chubby checker effect because it does the twist.
It exactly. Here you go. You and I are going to get along fine on our puns. Here is a very erudite paper written about designed experiments,
mm-hmm.
showing how in a pie diagram they found what A does, what B does, and so forth. But the unexplained, the error variance is great. Now, to you and me now, as statistical engineers, there's a red X in there, and that means fixing A, B, and C will not do anything in the factory.
Very little.
Because that red X, and I showed it here with the right triangle, 5 and 1,
mm-hmm.
and if you fix the 1 and remove that, the 5.1 goes down to 5, and you get 1/10 of what you thought you were going to get.
Yep.
On the other hand, if you fix the 5, which is the red X, and you move this to 4, then you do get a reduction of 1 unit, and this will go down to 4.1. So we're trying to illustrate by graphical methods mm-hmm. and simple things like this the very great power of statistical engineering. By the way, it's not like statistics. It's not like engineering alone. It's a new profession to combine.
So it's like an interaction.
Oh, yeah, in a sense. I think that's a good way to do it, to put it. So we're really trying, again, to avoid the Achilles heels, the assumptions, mm-hmm. which unfortunately are not real world.
Forgive my ignorance. ASIF. As if?
When we do this experiment here, mm-hmm. and we have a full factorial, the differences here are as if B were held constant.
Gotcha, okay.
Even though it's not actually held constant. It's the adding or subtracting of a constant from numbers that are not alike, making the other one act as if it was held constant.
Gotcha.
But what you get in a designed experiment and then what you have in a factory are different, because in a factory, the red X unknown is not held constant, is still unfortunately controlled. So that's why I put that.
Gotcha. In.
Thank you for asking that. Yep. Interactions are not that rare. Here's a common interaction. And this goes back over 200 years ago to 1774, I think. But Joseph right. Priestley, in front of the Royal Society in London, had a beaker of an invisible gas. And he says, this is looks like air, but it's not air. It's heavier than air. It stays in the beaker. He lit a match, and he put the flame of the match in the beaker, and the flame increased in size. It aids combustion. The audience of scientists way back in 1774 were amazed. Joseph Priestley has discovered a new element unknown to man, and they call it dephlogisted air. Now today it's oxygen that we're talking about.
It's easier to say.
Yep. In the audience was Lord Henry Cavendish. Excited as can be, the encyclopedia said only 2 weeks after his excitement in seeing Priestley discovering oxygen, Cavendish and his, shall I say, laboratory, not laboratory, in outside of London, he found by putting some acid on a piece of metal, he developed bubbles of an invisible gas, except his gas was lighter than air, it rose. Mm. He had to use an inverted beaker to capture it. So immediately he lit a match, put it in there, flame went out because there was no oxygen. He discovered hydrogen, another element unknown to man.
He's lucky it didn't blow up.
Well, now just a minute. You're ahead of the story.
Oh, okay.
Because, and I didn't get this from the encyclopedia, but as he was drafting his paper to become world famous for the next presentation at the Royal Society in London, he must have awakened one morning remembering Priestley's oxygen, aiding combustion, heavier than air. His lighter than air puts the flame out. He must have said, I wonder what would happen if I mix some of the oxygen with some of the hydrogen. And he never should have lit the match. It went boom.
Of course.
And so we know now for 200 years the chemical formula that says you get the right proportions, you get a highly explosive mixture. And the force of the explosion is greater than, as this graph shows, nothing that would happen on these three of these four combinations. Mm-hmm. But this combination, you got to put the dot up higher because you get into the explosive region.
I love that. That's a great technical term, boom.
Yeah, right, there you go. And that's the red X quite often in some solved mm-hmm. problems, a combination, 2, 3, or 4 more variables interacting. It can be discovered by the two axioms and the process of elimination. Mm-hmm. That cannot be predicted even by Nobel Prize winners. Believe me, it's... What you do with your past experience is hold it until you get the clues. Then your past experience will lead you more effectively to where the trouble comes.
Imagine how much further the world of science would be ahead today if they had been using your techniques 200 years
ago.
Well,
I hope, and I'm predicting, I'm not going to be here, but I'm going to be watching. I don't know whether I'm going to be looking up or looking down, but I'm going to be watching. And if anybody violates the logic of these techniques, I'm going to haunt the bejesus out of them.
You're going to come back and get them.
Yeah, that's it. So, interactions are really not that strange. It's just that people think they can predict them when they really can't. Believe me. Now we got all these tolerance limits that we have. And we're trying hard to basically get the right specs for our materials and so on. This happens to be an actual case from Millipore Corporation making very fine pore filters for taking bacteria and things invisible to the naked eye, sterilizing pharmaceutical solutions and things like it. And because of my work in pre-control, I was hired by Millipore in Bedford, Massachusetts, to control the thickness of the membrane filter, get that distribution narrower,
right,
so that they could get flow rates that the customer was interested
more
in.
More predictable.
Predictability. The high dots on here are good results. Low ones, the flow rate is too low. However, I took some samples when I was hired, and actually you need a minimum of 30, and I got more than 30. They had lots of filters about to be shipped to the customer. I measured the thickness, so I knew where on the horizontal axis to put the dot, put their test rig, got the flow rate, and I said, there doesn't seem to be any association between thickness and flow rate, even though as a scientist, as an engineer, you'd say that a thicker filter has a longer path through the pore and therefore higher liquid resistance. And if we can keep the thickness under control, we should get better control of flow rate.
Yeah.
That's not a red X, it's a white X or a blue one.
Yeah, we'd call this obviously a scatter diagram.
Yeah.
And the scatter diagram, without any further attention, would say no correlation between
right.
thickness and flow.
And if you hold the tolerance tighter and tighter, you're not going to get
That's
improved
right.
flow. There's a red X causing that big difference, and it has to be discovered.
Mm-hmm.
So when you discover it, we can then make another plot after you know what the red X is, like X here, and now you're going to get a definite line going.
Yeah.
Put scatter around it.
Yeah, a pattern.
Pattern.
Mm-hmm.
And we start with a customer Y that he needs to be enthusiastic, and we draw lines to the boundaries of the scatter. We get a parallelogram. And we find the old tolerance almost always is wrong, and the new tolerance can be graphically found. Keeps us in that parallelogram, and these two extreme corners will never go outside the customer enthusiasm range.
That's great.
So we don't believe in improving, getting 5% defective down to 3.5%, 3% down, 3.5% to 3%. In one breakthrough, by finding the red X, the idea is that you can then get absolutely over 100% conformance.
I'm glad you used that word, breakthrough. I think that's
an
important reflection of what your
right.
your tools and methodologies can do for people.
And there is always, always a red X, usually undiscovered. So it's just a detective process.
Yeah.
Here we go. Now, you'll never get real. You'll get customer satisfaction and competition the other way, but if you find the red X and know what it is, as from these previous little brief examples, then and only then can you really get customer enthusiasm. There are never two red X's for one Y.
Never?
Never. There's always a bigger one, a second to the bigger one, a third.
Okay.
And it's interesting because a lot of people don't yet believe that until they practice the statistical engineering on the shop floor. And it's so consistent, it's just amazing what happens. Now, after you find the red X and control it, what does the pink X become?
The red X.
The new red X.
Yeah, it's just like a Pareto analysis.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So there, you may have to go and find the second one. But very often, I never have to do that.
That would be like a succession of red X's.
Exactly. Exactly.
Okay.
Yep, there we go.
You know, the time is about 7 minutes before the broadcast is over, folks. So if you really want to talk to Dorian, and I hope you do, you'll give us a call or send us a fax. I was pleased that we had that first call, but Dorian has taken time out of a very, very busy schedule as he prepares for other consultancies and with other opportunities that he's got. And I think if you don't take advantage by calling 413-545-4871 or faxing us at 413-545-1227, you're missing a big bet. Dorian's here. I know he wants to answer your questions. He's a delightful gentleman. You really need to have the opportunity to chat with him. I hope in the just over 5 minutes remaining that you take this opportunity and do so. If you choose not to be identified on the air, that's fine. I've got enough ham in me that I think everybody likes to be identified on the air. But we'll see what happens. Hope you call.
Here's a diagram that basically I've tried to produce to show when you get to customer satisfaction, it's much better than you used to do, going along from left to right. But no matter where you are, on individual wise, it'll make you competitive. This is an achievable goal as you go further, and I thought the words here would go along with the previous slides. Mm-hmm. You start from wherever you are on an important quality characteristic perceived by the customer that maybe you aren't doing quite as well as your competition, and you move to the right in order to be able to get to where the competitors will wonder, how did you ever get there? You're having, as we showed you, with 2.1 million semiconductors, chips without a bad one, 30 million screw machine parts without a single bad
one. God, I hate to show off.
It does happen.
Okay.
So that's our kind of a guide, a path that we hope will be.
And you can enter this at any point.
Yep. Wherever you are now, your goal is to get there, and the tools we're talking about are the ones that will get you those breakthrough strategies.
That's great. Okay.
I'm predicting it's a new revolution. It's amazing how many large corporations have made great investments in the popular programs we have in the literature that we get in our public seminars and things of this nature. And they've invested a lot of time and effort, and big teams of people, try to get everybody with this mania for good quality, all of which is a nice thing to do on the surface, but they've lost their time and money. And today we have the problem that we can look back on now that we've had the 25th anniversary of our Apollo program. Do you remember what happened on Apollo 10?
Tell me.
We had an oxygen explosion and we lost three astronauts.
That's
on
right.
The ground.
Yeah.
What happened on Apollo 13? The explosion of the oxygen tank occurred on the way to the moon. And it was the lunar module that we worked on where we knew the weakest failure mode at a margin of safety. Those three astronauts were brought back. We had to go to the moon in order to get the gravity of the moon to reverse their direction. Mm-hmm. And we had to use redundant batteries to come through the atmosphere with our command module that has the heat shield to get them back, because the lunar module was never designed to come back.
Wow.
Through the atmosphere. It's burned up. But those three guys are very grateful. And so this thing we're talking about applies to margins of safety, reliability programs, quality after the customer gets it, as well as the quality at the time.
That pretty well covers the full range.
Yeah.
Okay, well, we've got about 2 minutes left, and I guess that pretty well...
We've got an appendix. It should be there.
Doesn't look to me like we got any more slides here.
Oh.
How about that?
They read blank sheets.
Yeah, they faked us out.
You'll find an appendix in your write-ups that tell you at the University of Dayton, my youngest son is giving the six-day seminar.
That's Richard?
Richard Shainin, yeah. And I gave you a phone number for the University of Dayton so that you could get dates and things like that.
Okay.
We've also given you references of printed material that can go beyond the 2 hours that we've just had here together. So those of you that are interested in becoming part of this new revolution, pay attention to the references in the appendix and go further with this thing. And may I tell you, it's a lot of fun. It's a lot better than guessing and being disappointed and then not reporting it to anybody and guessing again. Here you can boast that you really have found any red X on any problem very, very effectively.
Terrific.
So thank you very much for listening. And I do hope that someday we'll have a chance to meet person to person.
Beautiful. Ladies and gentlemen, it's been my pleasure here on Continuous Improvement Television to spend 2 hours with you again, along with my guest, Dorian Shainin, one of the pioneers, one of the great names in the area of continuous improvement. And Dorian, I expected you would be outstanding. You surpassed my wildest dreams. Thank you.
Thank you.
And I'll see you all next month, the month of November 1994. I'll be with Dr. George Labovitz of Boston University and Organizational Dynamics Incorporated, ODI, talking about his new book, Making Quality Work. And until that time, I'm Jack ReVelle. This is Continuous Improvement Television. See you then.